highlighting the kind of disparities which are developing in the conventional capabilities of Pakistan and India. And you have mentioned that there is a need for some kind of arms control agreement between the two countries for stabilization of for balance and for stability in the South Asian region. Your presentation also raises some questions, such as that can a gap between the conventional capabilities of two nuclear weapon states necessitate a development in the nuclear arena to plug that gap. Secondly, in the case of two nuclear weapon states, whether disparities in conventional capabilities indeed really matter, and can these be used by one against the other for blackmail, which is the last point that you had raised. Thank you very much. Now, the second speaker on the list is Dr. Adil Sultan. Dr. Adil Sultan belongs to the SPD, which is the guardian of our strategic assets. And Dr. Adil Sultan is one of the public faces of this very important organization, and he is the one who articulates our position on nuclear matters and nuclear posture. So he is going to talk about India's Gold Star doctrine influence on Pakistan's decision to introduce battlefield nuclear weapons, a very important, at times controversial subject. So,
thank you, Chair. Thank you, Dr. Jaiswal, a very good friend, for coming part of the presentation, especially the organ, the call of privacy in defense. Some of the issues that he has covered, I'll try and skip those because it's the same old topic, same old speaker, but slightly a different group. I want to thank Masanati for providing this opportunity and the Atlantic Council, and I'm happy that the friend from Atlantic Council, they finally managed after 3 years of struggle to come back to Pakistan and resume our discussions from where we stopped in 2014. The topic just to start with, the battlefield nuclear weapons. This term itself is quite controversial, because once you say battlefield, you assume that these weapons would be usable on the battlefield, which may not necessarily be the case in case of Pakistan, because how do we categorize battlefield nuclear weapons? Or some term it as tactical nuclear or non-strategic nuclear weapons. Is it the heat, range, or the purpose that characterize the type of weapon? But there's also a dilemma about deterrence, that once we say that these weapons will never be used, you are diluting deterrence. So these weapons only deter by the very fact that they remain usable. And that's how we continue to explain the rationale of Pakistan's full spectrum deterrence or technical nuclear weapons. But whatever I speak over here is in my personal capacity and not necessarily the official position of SPD. Because I will have some that also act as an academic also, and I teach at the university. And that's the liberty that I take to explain the difference between our concept of tactical nuclear weapons or nuclear strategy from the Cold War construct. It is also important to understand how different is South Asia's strategic environment from the Cold War. I'll briefly highlight some of these differences. The first one is unlike the Cold War, South Asian rivalry is between two conventionally asymmetric powers, whereas in the Cold War, this was not the case. This was slightly different. During the Cold War, technological developments were one of the primary guiding factors for doctrinal evaluation. This may not necessarily be true, especially in the case of Pakistan. Third, during the Cold War, the two former superpowers, they were engaged in a competition through achieving nuclear superiority and raising the cost of a nuclear exchange for each other. Four differences, unlike the Cold War, any nuclear use in the region, in South Asia, would have direct bearing on both India and Pakistan, which was not necessarily the case for the United States and Soviet Union. Finally, as compared to the Cold War model, the nuclear inventories of both India and Pakistan are quite modest. So keeping in view these differences, we need to develop our own strategic construct. Because this intellectual inertia, which continues to guide our concepts and determining from the Cold War experience, may not bring up the desired conclusions or the relevant conclusions that are applicable to South Asia. Forum 4, Dr. Small also referred to something, nuclear rivals. While the nuclear rivals are important to understand nuclear strategies of especially India and Pakistan, and he briefly mentioned, I'll just recap without elaborating further. In the academic jargon, we are all, and this small group is quite learned from our audience, we have different models to understand, and Scott Sagan has provided one model that states proliferate because of security, procedure, domestic, or possibly multi-causality. This is important to understand because once rivals are clear, you will also better interpret the nuclear strategies. And I will briefly cover that. So if you see India's nuclear program, it started its nuclear weapons pursuit, a dual purpose nuclear program, soon after independence. And they kept all the modest facilities that they had at that time outside the safeguards. It was 1958, as Brigadier Naeem Sadiq has also mentioned in his book, that Homi Bhabha, the father of nuclear program, he declared that India can develop a bomb in 18 months. And this was a period once they had very cordial and friendly relations with China. So India had no security concerns once it embarked on a nuclear weapons pursuit. Subsequently, China's nuclear test of 1964 did not trigger any urgency in India to develop their nuclear weapons program quickly as a deterrent against China. It took another 10 years, and in 1974, India tested its first nuclear devices by misusing the Canadian supplied reactor and fuel from the United States for conducting a nuclear weapon test. But very conveniently, it labeled this as a peaceful nuclear explosion to avoid any criticism. But subsequently, Indian scientists, and now it's open literature, they say it was a nuclear weapon test. So the primary factor behind India's nuclear pursuit is not necessarily security. Security nowadays is projected as justification against China to build its nuclear arsenal. But the genesis of nuclear programs are not directly related or proportional to their security concerns. So domestic politics and primarily prestige, which Dr. Jaspal also highlighted, were the main factors for India's nuclear pursuit. And these are also reflected in their doctrinal positions. And that's the point I want to emphasize. And once you will understand Pakistan nuclear travel, you will also understand the emphasis of this existential threat of security consideration for Pakistan in our nuclear policies and our rationale for developing our nuclear weapons. India, Pakistan started its nuclear program, weapons program, in 1975 after the 71 war and the India nuclear test of 74. So security was the primary factor because India had tested a nuclear weapon. So Pakistan then, after failing to get guarantees from its major allies at that time, and the world was not sensitive to Pakistan's security concerns, and that's the time the political leadership of that time resolved that we will build a bomb on our own, and we did develop our bomb subsequently. And became like an over nuclear weapon state in 1998 as a result of India's nuclear test. So the primary driver for Pakistan is security and nothing else. What was the impact of this nuclearization on South Asian strategic stability? Restored strategic balance between India and Pakistan, and war became an unthinkable option between two nuclear adversaries. And this was reflected even before Pakistan became a world nuclear weapon state. If some of you could recall the excise brass tacks of 1986 and 87, Pakistan had not tested. At that time, Pakistan's nuclear capability was known to be as ambiguous. The world was not very clear whether we had nuclear weapons program or not, though we had conducted core tests in 1984. Now that's the history. But this presence of capability to manufacture even a couple of bombs that helped in a way de-escalate 1986-87 military crisis once India was planning to launch a full offensive against Pakistan. So this was the first manifestation of nuclear deterrence, even though Pakistan had not become an old nuclear weapon state. Again in 1990, one could consider the impact of nuclear deterrence because the crisis was de-escalated, and of course there were other factors also. The role of the United States also in de-escalating. But the existence of this nuclear capability in the region did attract international powers to play a role and mediate these crises. Then came the 99 crisis that was also limited. Okay, I thought I had 15 minutes. Okay, I'll pass over then. 2001 and 2002 is the first classic case of nuclear deterrence. And the lesson that came out of 2001 and 2002 was that war between India and Pakistan and all of war is not possible. And probably that triggered amongst Indian decision makers to develop new war fighting concepts in the form of cold start doctrine or proactive operations. The slow mobilization during 2001 and 2002, to overcome this, Indian military planners came up with this novel idea of launching limited operation across the international border, launching shadow thrust 50 to 60 kilometers within a short time of 72 to 96 hours. Apparently to punish Pakistan, not realizing that Pakistan is a nuclear weapon state and any military action can trigger an all-out war and also a nuclear exchange. But the primary objective, without going into details of cold start doctrine, was to exploit the perceived gap below strategic threshold, Pakistan's strategic threshold, and launch military option. This was a dilemma for Pakistan. Not responding would have discredited its nuclear deterrence, and responding massively could have been a disproportionate response against limited incursions. So Pakistan introduced its short-range ballistic missiles that are also known as tactical nuclear weapons. But the very purpose of these weapons remained to prevent that even limited military incursion. So the objective is strategic, to prevent war at all spectrum of conflict. It's not a war fighting instrument, it's a war prevention instrument. And let me also elaborate on the misconceptions about Pakistan's full spectrum deterrence. Unlike the Cold War, where full spectrum was construed as having capabilities from tactical nuclear weapons to ICBMs, Pakistan's concept of full spectrum deterrence is to cater to the range of threats at the tactical, operational, and strategic level, without going into arms race. So once we say full spectrum deterrence, we are talking about the spectrum of Full spectrum deterrence is not a shift from credible minimum deterrence doctrine. As former Secretary also said, we will only do minimum what is required without engaging into an arms race. So full spectrum deterrence is not a quantitative shift, it's a qualitative response to the kind of threats that are emanating from the other side. And once we talk about deployment of weapons, people generally tend to forget there are conventional responses.